So welcome everybody. I'm so excited today. I'm here with Rodney Brooks and we are again at Playground VC in one of their lovely rooms that they've given us for the day here. Rodney is really a pioneer in robotics, has done so much. Currently the CTO and co-founder of Robust.AI, which we will talk about in a second, but the list of accomplishments, Rodney,
it's only because I'm old,
is so significant that we clearly can't cover everything that you've done. I mean, iRobot, professor at MIT, positions at Stanford, Carnegie Mellon, teaching a bunch of different places, but also creating real things too. I mean, just a remarkable background. I want to go all the way to the beginning though, Rodney,
okay.
Which is, how did you get into robotics? Like, what excited you and where did it begin?
I was born in Adelaide, South Australia in 1954. And to a working class family, they didn't know anyone had been to college, but I came out weird. And so in around 1962, my mother got these two American books that were called How and Why Wonder Books. One was on electricity and one was on giant brains and robots. And I was about 8 years old and I started trying to build robots and computers out of simple materials, wires, batteries, light bulbs, little switches that I made. And so from about age eight, I just wanted to build computers and robots and I haven't stopped.
I'd love the audience to get a clearer picture.
Yeah.
What is Robust.AI and what is it trying to do?
So we, about a year and a half ago, we pivoted. And we have a robot which, you know, looks like a shopping cart. Mm-hmm. And the fact that it looks like a shopping cart is really helpful because that means it's got a handle.
Mm-hmm.
You grab the handles, it now becomes yours. And you can move it any way you want. So now the person has a way, just like the person selects which thing in the search, now the person gets to override the robot. And they don't have to be trained. As soon as you see one person grab the handles, you know, it's like a shopping cart handle, you know, oh, I just grabbed the handles. And more than that, it's now a power tool because it amplifies how you're moving it. So you can have hundreds of kilograms on and you can move that around easily. But all those terra ops at the edge are making, there's a person in front. I won't let you push into another person. And so it's safe and it's, you know, you can't hurt other people because you've got that software which is making sure that it's not colliding with things, especially with people or ladders, because people are on ladders. That's the sort of thing we're doing. It's a robot that takes, I really like robots that people can use but take zero training for people to use. So back in the iRobot days, the Roomba had just a little handle. You could just pick it up and move it. It's a little robot. But we put the handle there so people could move it, so they could take over. And our engineer said, but they can't make it do X. We said, yeah, but with your interface, they couldn't make it do anything. Now they can do about 80% of the capability with zero training.
Yeah.
So always, to me, what's important is have things with zero training. You know, when you first ran a search engine, you didn't have to be trained on, oh, you got to select the one that's relevant to you. You just glanced and you knew that you had to select it. So zero training to me is really important.
Well, Rodney, I think zero training, but also like you were describing, it's the ability to make it work with the human.
Yes.
Right? Whether it is a set of search results, taking that analogy so easily into the, but you have to take it into the real world. So you have to make something that it's a controller that they already understand and know how to use.
Yeah.
It's a shopping cart type device. So if I touch it here and I roll it that way, it should roll that way.
Right. And by the way, these things are not constant in time. If you went back 40 years from now and gave someone a touch screen, they wouldn't know what to do.
Yeah.
Because they didn't exist. No one had seen one. Now we're all dealing with touch screens all the time. So you can put a touch screen on a robot and people know what to do. They even know, you know, that they have to have special gloves if they're wearing gloves so that they'll touch. They know all this stuff. So it's matching the interface to where people are today, what they're used to, and that's how you get usable robots.
So tell us a little bit about the promise of robust AI. I know it's earlier and it's in the company's development, so you're just testing some things out now. Where do you hope it's headed, and what is the big vision for it in the future?
Well, we see these are the first time mobile robots have been able to be interacted with, large mobile robots. Yep. We had the Roomba, but where you can actually just grab them. And being able to grab a robot, move it around, and then, if you're in a factory, you say, you can touch the screen. It's got a touch screen. This is the location I want these parts picked up from. That's the environment we're in now. In the long scale, I see this sort of thing being in our homes, in our grocery stores, anywhere we are, robots that you can grab and interact with.
If you look forward another decade, another 15 years, 20 years, what do you think robots are going to be in our lives?
Here's an incredible pull. Any tools that can let individuals stay in their home longer and be independent and have dignity is going to be a big win. I don't think of it as a companion robot, but I think as tools that let people maintain their control of their life longer. What should that be like? Well, the Roomba helps because you can, you know, someone can have their floors cleaned without having a really expensive robot.
Not able to stoop over.
And they don't need an expensive robot, or they don't need to hire someone to clean their floors. So for lower income people, the Roomba is great. So anything that can help people is going to be a big economic incentive for it. All that remains is to invent those robots. And that's, if you ask me, well, what are they going to be doing? I don't know. But everyone out there, go invent them, because you'll make a load of money and make people's lives better. And I'm getting older. I want a better life. So, I'm serious about that. I think that demographic inversion is just going to drive our world as much as climate change and as much as urbanization, which is also happening. Those three things are what is going to steer our world for the next 50 years, and finding places that fit into there are going to be important, are going to be big deals.
So I know you say you don't know what they're going to be, but brainstorm for a minute with me. So you have, of course, the Roomba, but other things that allow you to stay in a home for longer into your older age, would it be health medical aids?
Here's one thing that drives people into managed care is when they can no longer get into and out of bed by themselves. And that's a place where you lose dignity, by the way. So something that helps people stand up, sit down with dignity. So people who still have their mental facilities, but their physical body is not so doing so well, they often have to go into managed care, and now their personal dignity is totally gone because they're so reliant on other people to do the everyday things for them. So anything there can help people. That's not necessarily going to help someone with dementia. It's a different issue. But people who have their mental facilities and their bodies are not working well, anything that can help them be independent. And we already have passive handles inside baths and showers so that people, elderly people, but there'll be lots of active things which help them, like getting into bed, out of bed, etc.
So it's almost some of those things you see in some movies these days, the robotic lifts or efforts, the robotic legs that help you in and out.
And it's all going to be what is easy to use and doesn't require, someone to strap you in, because if you have to get someone to come and strap you into those legs, you've lost your self-reliance there. So how is it that it's going to help the person independent of other people?
Ronnie, I love it. It goes back to your no training.
Yes.
Right? No training, easy to use, intuitive, something that delivers power and value
without needing extra help, and without making you feel infantilized is going to be important.
Rodney, this has been an amazing conversation. Thank you so much
for spending
some time with us today. I really appreciate the conversation. I think our audience will appreciate it too.
There's lots to do, lots of opportunities.